Now over to fragility. I think it's great. Maybe the kind of key point I'm making, or one of those in this presentation, is this, that it's good to mix different competences and different areas of work, be it then more theoretical or academic approaches, and then practitioner approaches like I am representing here, or then different fields of development cooperation or economy. I think the world needs in general do much more in this merging and pushing different fields together in order to achieve greater impact in the work that we do. And I certainly have difficulties in following some of my co-presenters text, because it gets so deep in the academic world, but I'm sure there are competent people who can then merge both the more practitioner and then the academic work. But luckily, like Rachel was mentioning there, I've been co-author of one of these more academic samples, which I'm shortly presenting also today, and this is about the secondment of FinChurch aid staff to the government of Somalia, which was written a case on it about the one mechanism to support a fragile state. So what is FinChurch aid? We are we're the largest development cooperation and humanitarian aid organization in Finland, which is focusing very much in the states of fragility. I joined FCA 10 years ago, and I think then we were discussing that, or our point was that we are working where others are not. And I think it tells already this, that the fragile states, those who in today's language are being at risk, being left behind, those are our focus countries, and I think it's a good one. And this is an approach that the rights-based approach also is directing us to watch. It's those contexts which are underprivileged and most fragile, people who and groups who are most discriminated against, that we should be looking at. So you see there some of those countries where we work at, Somalia being one of them still. We work three priority areas. It's right to peace, right to livelihood, and right to quality education, which are very much interlinked to each other. For example, I've been working in Eritrea now for a long time, and although our intervention there is, I would say, strictly about right to quality education, we cannot be blind to the connections that there are to the livelihoods, that where are these trained people then going, what about the jobs, the livelihoods options there are, and the implications to peace and stability in their societies and regionally. Just one slide on the what I would call the evolution of these internationally agreed guidelines in addressing fragility. These are something that I think we as FCA, we've been following, we've been studying what they mean, and it's been a kind of steady progress. I think the world entity has invested a lot in these processes, the governments, but the civil society actors have been firmly on board. I would say increasingly on board. The New Deal for Engagement in Fragile States, established in Busan in 2011, there the civil society organizations were explicitly already part of the process. And it's a framework which was, I would say, much more credible, than more tangible, not just the rich donors talking to the fragile states, but really those fragile states being on equal footing in the process, and then in addition the civil society in those contexts, fragile context, and in internationally, like FCA, we were on board. And then finally, the SDG 16 on peace, justice, and strong institutions, which is very much continuing the spirit of picking up where the New Deal has reached. So this is a framework which FCA also has been following, and which the case study in the publication that Rachel was mentioning is very much referring to. I think this case, it's still the boldest thing in my, if I would write my memoirs, so this would feature in the biggest way there, but I'm happy that now it's been written in more professional way, not least thanks to Rachel and Rauli, of course, who was the other, Rauli Lepistö, the other, the main author in the article. And if I'm thinking of the study or the case, so FinChurchAid had been working in a fragile state, Somalia, for a long time. We had been working with the religious leaders and traditional leaders, with the clans, which really, really represent the people, and they have the legitimacy. And we knew this, and we had been supporting their peace-building work quite successfully, I would say, with the generous support of the government of Finland. So Finland, the Ministry for Foreign Affairs, really saw this as a priority, and our funding was big from the inception when we started around 2008. We had also been working with the international community, with the United Nations, the UNPOS, the UN Political Office for Somalia, but we hadn't been working with the government. And of course it was, the position of the transitional federal government was not the strongest, so it was contested all the time, but still we felt that based on what FCA believes in, our rights-based approach, that we not only work with the rights holders, but also with the duty bearers and the accountability between the two, that we really need to ask the question from the government that how can we help? What can we do for you? And we come to one sunny afternoon in Nairobi in 2012, when we are sitting with the Minister of Constitution and Reconciliation, Abdi Hosh, and I think it was then myself asking the question that, Mr. Minister, what can FinChurchAid do for you? How can we support? And the minister had an immediate answer. He was pointing to my colleague, next chair, Mahdi Abdile, and saying that I want this man to be my right-hand man in the crucial state-building processes in the months to come. And this is a textbook example that we are not, imposing something. We are asking what the, local ownership, that what does the government want? What does the duty bearer want? And there's a request, and then we were able to pull it through, that we were able to send this colleague of ours, so Mahdi Abdile, to the field. Many issues came together, that he was willing to do it. Not an easy solution with the family man, living in Finland for 20 years and now going to Somalia, which was far from safe, for example. It's also very clearly kind of logical continuation of the internationally agreed frameworks that I was discussing earlier about the local ownership, how we need to be working. So it really came together. We look at the ministry. It was only the minister plus one. So now it was three persons with our FCA secondment there. So it was clearly badly needed thing to do. But I think by the time of the writing, 2014-15 of the article, I considered this a huge success, and I still do, and something that really can be replicated. And I I still think that you know, this kind of capacity support as one form of development assistance or development cooperation, it's something that, you know, everybody should have in their toolbox. But then again, if you think about impact, then I think we can be a bit more critical that is this, even if replicating such secondments, will this achieve overcoming fragility? And I think it needs a few more studies before we go there. And there has been lots of critique towards the New Deal and how things are working. And the next slide, please first read it and then I start talking, because I think it's the most crushing critique, which is very difficult to counter, but that's an impressive one. This was an email by an UNDP colleague working in one of the countries where the Ebola struck in 2015 in West Africa. And I was then working, you know, as part of the home of the New Deal, the International Dialogue for Peace Building and State Building, and asking for an appointment with this guy whom I knew well, and he was very sharp, and but I was very open that it comes with the New Deal hat on and I'm not strictly FCA now. And then comes this response about aspirational model and distant donor rhetoric, and unfortunately, I could confirm that this was the case. In my interviews in those countries, I discussed with the donors, with the Swedes, with the US, and it was basically snake in the barrel. They were saying that the countries in concern, they don't want this. We have tried this for a couple of years and our capitals are pushing it and it's not flying, and why don't they believe? So this kind of aspirational model, it clearly showed that although it had and still has many of the good ingredients, is the method still wrong if it's not flying, if the impact is not there? I shift into a completely different domain now, that but I think it's based on this at least partly failure of the internationally agreed ways to address fragility that we have been as FCA working on. So what would work? How can we then build genuine local ownership in those countries where which are in fragility trap or in situations of fragility? The statistics is of course very grim, that 20-30 80% of the world's poor will be in fragile states, so there's so much to do. And we have been developing in FCA a new instrument which would address one of the key issues in which is also part of the New Deal, which is this kind of economic logic in overcoming fragility. And now this is again about the mixing of the fields. I have privilege enough to work with a colleague who is coming strictly from the financial investment field, and we have been developing this tool called FinChurchAid Investment, which will be launched very, very soon, and you will hear more about it. But it will be investing in small and medium-sized enterprises in those countries where FCA is working. And you know, there's a good statistics to support this, that you look at the SDGs and how, what is the gap in financing? 2.5 trillion a year, the annual gap in reaching the SDGs. And you look at the expectations towards the private sector, it's huge expectations actually that they are stepping in, because the traditional development cooperation funding, it's either decreasing or staying where it is now. It's not exponentially increasing. So something new needs to be there. And now the world has said that it's the private sector. But it seems that the incentives are not always there. But the problem statement actually is quite clear about the role of SMEs in the developing world, that this so-called missing middle, that there are small and medium-sized enterprises which are willing to grow. There are people who are enthusiastic to grow their businesses, hire new people, pay better taxes, for governments which desperately need this money for the good public spending. The logic is there, but the funding for these SMEs is missing. So this is why what we are now doing in the as we speak, not alone of course, but with partners, is to seek ways to support these small and medium-sized enterprises in those countries where FCA is operating. And this is a further slide on the problem that this so-called missing middle problem, that the financing is unavailable. And now this what I have been saying, it relates to all developing countries, of course. And this is the main problem for the whole SDGs and the magnitude. But what about then if we start talking about fragile states? It's those states where FCA is currently operating. So we see a big possibility for us being one of those partners which is looking for solutions in the most fragile states. You can understand the companies who want profit, they are not eager to first start investing in Somalia, South Sudan, CAR, or Eritrea. There's a lot of work that needs to be done on before such investments can go. But due to our country presence in those countries, perhaps we can be helpful. But it takes a lot of work. But now we are having one tool which hopefully could be one of those contributing to these fragility problems in the world that we are operating in. This is the final slide. It's a very superficial conclusions, but maybe just a reminder to ourselves also that the fragility is not overcome. There's been lots of good studies, lots of good recommendations by the World Bank, the OECD, and UNDP, and others. But many countries risk being left behind. I think this is it's time to wake up in the SDGs already now, because like I mentioned, this financing for the SDGs in the most fragile states, it's an issue that should be raised by us and by others. Yes, I already mentioned about this blurring of the lines between development actors, development finance institutions, and private sector. I think much more should be done, adding also the academic side here. So I really look forward to understanding better the researches also done by fellow speakers here, and it all should be just directing to better impact on ground from our perspective. Thank you.